Challenging, creative movie openings. I sure do. Now that one is from, I think, 62 or 63. It's a mad world. Now I saw that when it came out. Now that'll help position you. I saw that during the Cold War. But you know, you see these things like that, like Saul Bass titles, and you just you're taken from your where you are in your seat, basically, and that they position you for the movie. It's not so much that the movie is being presented to you, you're being massaged for the movie. And one of the things that I find quite boring these days is so many movies, for the last few decades, begin with just the name. And I think that started with Star Wars, and that Lucas had to get special dispensation from the Directors Guild because his name was supposed to be at the beginning and you're supposed to have the normal titles and all of that sort of stuff. Anyway, there's all kinds of rules in the contracts and the union contracts and whatever. But that has now gone so far that all you get is, say, Lord of the Rings, Return of the King. That's what you get. And you take it right into the movie, and a lot of people like that. I always liked titles. I wanted to see everything about, not necessarily the end titles where it's all made until the end, that sort of thing, but I like to know who's in it. But I don't get my wish anymore, and I love the animation titles. Love at least the James Bond ones. They don't cheat you out of those, you know, like that is part of the ride. And it's they're doing a wonderful job, I think, since Morris Binder died, who used to do the classic ones with Roger Moore, Sean Connery, and so on. Anyway, I want to give you a sample of one of the later ones that's done, one of the new ones, and that was from 1995, GoldenEye. And I really am going to show the whole thing for that, because I love those titles. I like that theme song. I like the movie. And I thought it was a fantastic job setting up that movie.
See reflections on the water. More than darkness in the depths. See him surface and never a shadow. On the wind I feel his breath. GoldenEye, I found his weakness. GoldenEye, he'll do what I please. GoldenEye, no time for sweetness, but a bitter kiss will bring him to his knees. See him move through smoke and mirrors. Feel his presence in the crowd. Other girls, they gather around him. If I had him, I wouldn't let him out. Chain, take them to the spot. GoldenEye, I'll show him forever. It'll take forever to see what I've got. You'll never know how I watched you from the shadows as a child. You'll never know how it feels to get so close and be denied. It's a gold and honey trap I got for you tonight. Revenge, it's a kiss. This time I won't miss. Now I've got you in my sight. With a golden eye.
Golden Eye, you can see all those symbols on the version. And this was, let me see, 87, 89. Yes, there was a long gap between Bond movies because the first Dalton one was 87, his second one was 89. And then there were more studio troubles or whatever, and trying to figure out what to do, I guess. And I don't know if Albert Broccoli died in the interim or not, but it was 6 years, almost 6 years at least, between Bond movies. So by that point, the last time they did a Bond movie in 89, that's when the Berlin Wall came down, and all, you know, the complexion of Europe changed. So that's what those symbols are about, falling, you know, the hammer and the sickle and all of that stuff. So that one, to me, is one of the most provocative and most evocative of the titles in the James Bond canon, because it actually had some politics in it for a change too. It wasn't just a mega mind trying to blow everything up. So I really enjoyed that, and I thought the song by Bono and The Edge and Tina Turner's delivery and everything was just spectacular. I really, really like it. And just watching that now as I'm doing this, I feel like watching the movie again. See, this is what I mean. It really sets me up, you know? I really, really like that. And now we're going to have a sample, if not the whole thing, I don't know yet until I look at it again. Of course, one of the famous ones by the 60s genius Saul Bass. I think it's Bass, I don't think it's Bass. And this is Vertigo. So sit back and enjoy that, because Hitchcock knew how to set a theme, that's for sure. I think that's extremely evocative in the same way that, but with more energy, North by Northwest is evocative when you see those titles. You know, and those titles are done like the grid of the office building, the panes, you know, of the curtain wall construction for the towers, like the Seagram building. I'm going to stop now because I'm going to do some other parts of this. I have other ones I want to talk about, things like some of the Western titles and how evocative they could be. Some of the titles from, say, the Coen brothers, I think that I can find something for that. And then I'm going to be doing one, as long as I can find it on YouTube, because it's not like I have a collection of them. I'd like to find some titles from my favorite television shows, particularly The Avengers. And I'll do a special one on that one. Anyway, that's enough for now from Michael from Red Chair Diaries in Nova Scotia, and it is 23rd of May, Monday, 2011, and it's Victoria Day. It's a holiday in Canada. So that's it. See you at the movies. Bye.